welcome to the Powell Not Found podcast. This is Mark Powell coming to you from my apartment with episode 3. This time, we're going to have a pretty good show for you today. We're talking Cashman. We're talking the Yankees. We're talking some Indiana Jones. We are talking some health documentary stuff on Netflix that I've been watching recently that's been really kind of intriguing. We have a loaded show for you today. Again, this is the Powell Not Found podcast located on YouTube. I am going to try to make it a commitment to myself to try to get this thing up on actual podcast services. I know this is primarily a video show, but if we can get it in as many hands as possible, maybe, just maybe, we can build out an audience. This last weekend has been cold. It's snowed over here in the DC area, so it's given me a lot of time to catch up on certain things, like the Yankees offseason, like some health documentaries. You Are What You Eat is going to be the highlight later on in the show. A really interesting documentary that documents the progress of twins, basically going from going with an omnivorous diet and a plant-based diet. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what changing my diet has been like, both the successful times I've done it and both the times that I've failed miserably. But that's going to be coming a little bit later on the show. Everybody, go ahead and like and subscribe again on the YouTube channel. Building that audience is what we're trying to do for the 52 straight weeks that we are doing this show. But first, we've got basically the music highlight of the show. Thank you. This is how I'm going to transition most of my segments. It is another song called I Want to Tell You Simply That I Love You. It's an older song. I wrote this song about 7 years ago. It is a country song. I don't like this song very much, but everybody that I play it to says that it's catchy. And so who am I to disagree with the masses? This song was kind of written in haste a little bit. There's been a couple attempts that I've tried to write songs with a Johnny Cash type influence. I think I watched Walk the Line, and that tells you just how highly influential that I am. I watched that movie and immediately was like, I want to emulate this kind of lifestyle, which is probably not a good thing. But that kind of music was stuck in my head. I listened to a lot of Johnny Cash, Willie Nelson at the time, and I think this song came out of that. Because it's a very, you know, almost country sounding, which I think is why I didn't like it, because it was a different sound coming from me. I think the chord progressions are a little bit simple until you get to a bridge. And the bridge is something that I was very, very proud of in the song, because it's such a stark comparison from the rest of the song. You'll know the bridge is coming because you'll hear a little bit of an out-of-tune woo in the recording. But let me get this loaded up here. I want to tell you simply that I love you. Let's go ahead and listen to this. Let's push it basically with the lower third. And yeah, let's take a listen.
Well, I wanna tell you simply that I love you, day I die. Day I die. The pieces of my instrument weave the oldest sacrament, a sang of love's creation, I suppose. Though it may be sacrilege, it's with utmost privilege that when I hold you close to me, that everybody knows that I just wanna tell you simply that I love you. But I never, ever, ever found the words. Well, I wanna tell you simply that I love you. And I'll try, yes, I'll try, I'll try, yes, I'll try. Till the day I die.
That was I Want to Tell You Simply That I Love You. Again, hearing that song back over again, there's a lot of stuff going on. I like the fact that it just starts. There's no buildup. I feel like a lot of the songs I've written in the past just have a strong buildup for, waiting for that instrumentation to kick in. This one's just boom, it's there, right? Everything, the guitars, the bass. It'd be interesting to kind of put a drum track behind that because I think at the time, I think I was using synths. I was using the piano just hooked up to a MIDI to try to create that kind of sound. But again, that was I Want to Tell You Simply That I Love You. You can find that on powell.found.bandcamp.com. All of the songs, I should say, are there via suggested donation. They're free to download. You can just put in zero if you want, preferably. If you want to throw something, that's fine, but you don't have to. That's the whole point. It was about exposure, not really about making money doing this stuff. But that was I Want to Tell You Simply That I Love You. I think that song's growing on me. It only took 7 or 8 years to finally have this thing grow on me. So let's talk about our first subject, first topic of discussion. Let's talk about Brian Cashman finally decided to address the media after the signing of Marcus Stroman. They had a press conference kind of introducing them. They typically do that kind of stuff whenever a new athlete signs with the team. Recently, it's been kind of interesting because they've all been over Zoom, which is strange. I think the reasoning that they did it with Juan Soto is because it was a one-year deal, and he's going to be a free agent after the season end. And so it was truly, in all sense of the word, a rental. But Marcus Stroman is signing a 2-year contract, and they still did it over Zoom. I think they mentioned during the actual press conference that it was basically due to I think he was moving or something like that, and so they did it over Zoom. But it did kind of make me miss a little bit of the grandeur that usually comes with these signings, right? Alex Rodriguez signing with the Yankees, right? You have the number 13, you have the dais of all the people. Judge, even last year when he re-signed with the Yankees, you had, I believe, Jeter, Cashman, Randy Levine, the president of the New York Yankees, all up there. It was a big, momentous signing. Now, one could argue that the reason that they did this is because he's the captain. It was a franchise player. You know he's going to sign basically to the end of his career. It wasn't like he was going to go anywhere. It was like the Derek Jeter signing, when Derek Jeter became a free agent. I think there's clips of him saying he's not going anywhere. He even told his agent he's going to be up front with them, which is not a great negotiating move, as he said. But maybe they had the pomp and circumstance, but I feel like these signings, it feels like the Yankees are running out of money. Like, it's like, oh, let's just do it over Zoom, which kind of takes a little bit of the excitement away. I don't know how the reporters kind of feel about it, but it does kind of take the excitement away from the actual signing. And I wonder if it's a little bit impersonal. And that said, I feel like as the you know, as the pandemic has worn on, and as Zoom calls have become more customary to our society, I wonder how much the reporters kind of feel like, we can't connect with this player because we're not in the room. During the pandemic, they mentioned that. They mentioned that, you know, they couldn't get a sense of who anybody was because they were stuck behind this virtual wall. So it's kind of interesting that they're still doing this to this day. It kind of feels a little bit cheap, even when we I don't know, let me see if I can actually push the picture of the Yankees introducing Stroman. This is over a Zoom call here. If you're listening to the podcast, just go to the video feed on YouTube. Let me push this here. And this is him over Zoom addressing the media over questions. You can't really see the media. You never really could, but this is, you know, him clearly from some room in his apartment delivering this thing. It just doesn't give you the same type of appeal. But during this, they introduced Stroman. He seemed like he was giving, you know, pretty stock typical answers. I wonder how quickly the Yankees media actually gets to a new athlete once they sign with the team. You got to imagine there's some sort of PR rep that's like, this is what the fans like. The fans like to hear that you're a competitor. The fans like to hear that you're here to win a championship, that nothing else matters, a championship or else. It seems like the Yankees have the same sound clips since 1990, have had the same sound clips since 1996, all about just keep on repeating championship, just keep on repeating championship, and the fans will love you. Now since 2009, we have not had a championship. So a lot of those, I want to call them Derek Jeter-esque vanilla statements have started to wear thin after a while. They just seems like sound bites. It almost seems like every single athlete is reading off a teleprompter. But they introduced Stroman. He talked about basically the relationship between him and Cashman. Again, I think I told you earlier that this was going to be a thing that they were going to address. And I actually do have the audio clip. This is from the New York Post of him talking about signing and making up with Stroman. Let me see if I can get that up here. And doing some production on the fly. Let's see here. Let me push this and play.
I mean, so listen, you know, it was my bad. Like, I got asked a question back, I believe, when this was it 2019, off the top of my head? Whenever that trade from Toronto to the Mets happened, we were also trying to trade for him. So obviously we targeted him, had interest in him. And I was asked a question why we didn't pay the ransom. And I think Toronto, being within the division, was certainly going to ask more of us at that time. And so trying to frame at that time, you know, why we didn't push through all the way and go all in on that particular transaction, even though we were on them. You know, I just said, you know, for the amount of talent they wanted back, it wasn't going to be enough of a difference maker. And that was my bad, because then how it played wasn't certainly how it was intended.
This has got to happen a lot, right? As a general manager of a team, I think the quote was something like, and don't quote me on this, the quote was something something like, "Oh, he wasn't a difference maker." And you know, when you're trading for a whole bunch of players, I imagine at some point you have to be looking at your roster, and it has to be in regards to what would have made a difference to the team. And I think that's what Cashman was trying to say. And the reason I bring this up is because, man, is it a slow off season if this is the actual topic of conversation. There's not really a lot of talk. Eventually, this press conference kind of moved on to the actual construction of the roster, which is probably more important than actually the relationship between the newly signed player and the general manager in the front office. I'm not sure which, if there has been any player who's had an amicable relationship with their front office. If there has, shout it out. But I don't think that that's necessarily common. This is it's a business relationship. It's really a relationship between the front office and the agent of the player, not even the player themselves. So the responses were pretty vanilla coming out of this press conference, which made me think, why do they even do these things at all? Because it seems to be the same thing. Hey, we've made up. We're here to win a championship. We're going to be, you know, fighting our hardest out there. We've got a great lot of players out there. The reporters asked them about the infield, alignment, and the answer again was still pretty benign, saying, "Hey, you know, I'm a sinker baller. These guys are great behind me." Again, why do they even do these Zoom conferences? They did eventually move on to something of a little bit more importance, which was Rodon's health, coming off of that season where he started on July 2nd, when he debuted, and he was just struggled and scuffled. They said that Carlos Rodon reported early to camp and that he's in great shape. They also kind of echoed the same sentiment with Giancarlo Stanton, who finished the season with a 191 batting average. And so it will be exciting to see how those two do. I think that's going to be the main difference maker, right? If these two can actually have a season, then you start looking at the Yankees roster as a pretty powerful threat. But these guys are older. These guys have played in the league a long time. There haven't been many examples outside of the crazy steroid era in baseball where someone's gotten older and just gotten better with time. Usually these are there's gradual declines, and we definitely saw it in Stanton last year. I mean, him hitting a fastball was not like him hitting a fastball years before. So hopefully if they start to bounce back, then you start to see a really full roster. They started asking Brian Cashman again if there's going to be any moves in the future, and they seem to imply that they were all set. It seems like the Yankees' MO over the last couple of years has been basically make a big splash and then say you're going to do more and kind of smoke out a little bit by the end, or what's the phrase I'm looking for? Basically just like not follow up with any more big trades. I mean, they got Juan Soto, they have Alex Verdugo, they got Trent Grisham. So you're starting to see kind of an infield alignment of DJ LeMahieu at third, Volpe, shortstop, second base Glaber, Anthony Rizzo at first. You're probably going to have a battery, Trevino and Austin Wells. Seems like they're setting him up to be the backup catcher. I don't think that Rortvedt, unless Rortvedt is a bigger piece of the puzzle and they don't want to call up Austin Wells, that might be the option. And then it looks like you're going to have Verdugo, Judge, and Soto in the outfield with DH as Stanton. And your bench is looking like a Grisham and Cabrera, Peraza. I mean, you might want to add one more bench piece because it's pretty sparse. And that's why, going back to the other episode that we talked about a week before, not signing Kiner Falefa might have been a little bit of a mistake. I liked him off the bench. I liked the fact that he was a great utility player. He was a slap ball hitter. You knew he was hitting the ball. It wasn't going to be a strikeout or an absolute outcome, as they like to call it in baseball. You knew he was going to put contact on the ball, and sometimes you just needed that. You just needed the ball in play, put pressure on the defense, and so that is what the alignment looks like. I'd still like them to go out and get another piece. these relievers. Josh Hader just signed for an insane amount of money. I don't want to see you spend that much, but just something, a backup player, something that's available in the league that maybe can just put wood on the ball. And then we'll see how these guys kind of turn out. I think by the end of the first month, by maybe mid-May, we should have more of a feel of how this Yankee lineup's going to go. If Juan Soto just goes from the gate, I think that you're going to see a different dynamic batting order. Aaron Boone basically said that he was thinking about lineups in a previous interview this week, that Juan Soto hitting second, Judge hitting third, Rizzo hitting fourth, maybe Stanton behind him. I mean, that's a pretty – if everyone's going, that is a pretty phenomenal lineup. If everyone's not, we might see a repeat of last year, an 82 and 80 season. But anyway, interesting stuff from Cashman. I think we'll probably hear from him probably one more time before the pitchers and catchers report, maybe. Seems like they're doing this monthly. Wasn't as fiery as, maybe we'd like to see him. I thought the explosive Cashman was a lot more entertaining, but we're getting information. We're slowly getting it in drip feeds, and I think it's starting to kind of, you're starting to see these teams start shaping up before pitchers and catchers report in February 14th. So we'll see. We'll see what happens. Hopefully this Yankee team lines up. Hopefully they get a couple more pieces added. I think you're starting to see what the 2024 Yankees is about. So with that, let's transition over to what also happened this week. Back to the beginning, shall we? The Indiana Jones and the Great Circle reveal. The Xbox Developer Direct stream happened this week, showcasing about five or six games on the straight to consumer feed. There, it was a beautifully shot showcase. I kind of talked over it. That's also available on the channel. There were some production difficulties doing that stream, but you live and learn. But this one, obviously coming from Machine Games, they pitched a Indiana Jones game, which is really interesting because the classic example of Indiana Jones game was Uncharted, which was basically almost one-to-one Indiana Jones with different names. Indy meet Nathan Drake. Nathan Drake meet Indy. It's the same person. This one, really, really cool visuals. The sound of like Troy Baker playing Indiana Jones sounds very much like a sound alike for Harrison Ford. And we talked a little bit on that piece of content that I made that I wonder why they just didn't get Harrison Ford. But you're talking about a game that features young Indy. They just de-aged him in the last film in Dial of Destiny. And even when they de-aged him, I still thought, and maybe this is just my critical eye, or maybe this is just knowing that that they're using this kind of AI capability, that he's old, you know, that I felt like you could really still see his age. There's one shot in Dial of Destiny where he's running. And I think it's just, it might be him, maybe it's a body double, but it just felt like he was hobbling along like somebody who is a little bit older than normal. It didn't seem like young Indy, and his voice was still a little bit too grovelly. So maybe that's why they kind of went with a different voice actor, aside from the fact that Harrison Ford has been pretty public about retiring this character for good. I still think this is interesting. It's interesting that it's in the first person. They do show that you can kind of pull it back from a third-person perspective to see Indy. Obviously, there's cinematic cutscenes, but this looks like a Lucas film, an Indiana Jones film, pretty much one-to-one. I think this is going to sell gangbusters if it works, which is always the
the problem with Bethesda made games is that, is it going to function? You know, I think we've seen with Fallout, with Starfield, bugs are necessarily not their strong suit about sorting those things out. But this game looks kind of amazing. I'm excited to jump into it. They say there's a 2024 release date with this game, which I would assume that if they're not willing to put a date on it or a season on it, it's probably going to be delayed. But, man, does it look good? It looks like you're in a movie right there. So I feel like Uncharted finally has its rival on the other console. So, again, coming to Xbox in 2024, what a cool look. It's cool to see Indiana Jones in this kind of fidelity coming to this platform. So I thought that was pretty cool. The other games that were actually showcased on the Direct, there was like a Civ-type game. There was a Avowed. There was a Mana game that was also revealed. But from those studios that Xbox acquired, I think this is the main get. You know, this is the thing that's really probably going to bolster those Xbox sales that probably need to be a little bit higher. But yeah, what a cool game. What a cool looking game. Let's transition to our third and final topic of the podcast here. It might be a short one this week. So this week, where is it? Bam. This week, decided to go back. I was trying to watch a movie a week. That was one of the resolutions, along with my standard resolutions of losing weight, you know, doing all that stuff. But I was, which directly competes with losing weight, is doing a stationary activity like watching a movie. But around this time, there always seems to be, because of those resolutions, there always seems to be some sort of health documentary. And I kind of eat these things up like nobody's business. These things, You Are What You Eat, a twin experiment, came on Netflix. And I heard some people talking about it. I heard some people writing about it. And some people told me to go see it. So I sat down, watched the whole documentary in about 2 days, and it is a, let me press play here. It is a documentary that basically follows the story of, follows a study that focuses on 22 twin pairs. I think they end up telling you at the end of the documentary that 21 of them finished the study. And one of them is on a omnivorous diet. One of them is on a plant-based diet. And they kind of track them through 8 weeks, kind of really controlling their diet just to see what the effects are of a plant-based diet and a meat-based diet. The documentary is shot like a TLC documentary. It's hard to explain, but I feel like we've seen so many of these character-driven documentaries that we kind of know what to expect. You're going to get a good look into their characters. They're always very peppy characters, and it's a fun watch. The first episode is very much trying to let you know who these twins are, and they pepper it. They kind of cut it together with their I hesitate to call it science because they do preface it with this is not medical advice, but they, you know, it's the science of their study, right? So, not medical advice, not science. But the science of their study still is holds up, but They talk about basically what would happen if we basically took these identical, twin sets that have identical DNA and see if there's any kind of impact. And it's a really interesting story. It's a it's a it does get a little bit, I don't want to say preachy, but it feels like at some point they're yelling at you because it's so passionate. There's appearances by Eric Adams, by Cory Booker. If you ever want anything to be said passionately, just break out the Cory Booker button. And he's there. It was at one point I thought, because I was not expecting him to show up, I was like, is this a Senate hearing? And there are some moments of genuine, it makes you really think. I think the best things about these documentaries is that regardless of whether some people might say, hey, the science is incomplete. Some people might say, hey, this is they're preaching the truth, right? Who can say until you actually look at the actual details of what they're doing? But it does make you think about what you are eating, which is exactly the point of these things. I found myself yesterday after finishing the documentary walking to Whole Foods and looking at plant-based Beyond Burgers to see if, hey, is this something that I can implement in my diet? It gave me the same feeling of when I first read The Whole 30. And when I first read The Whole 30, which is by Melissa and Dallas Hartwig, it kind of made me really, the way it was written in a way that really appealed to me because it was a step-by-step, day-by-day plan. And it made me start cooking more. It made me start thinking about what I was eating. It made me start looking at the supermarket in a way that when I was mid-20s did not look at in the same way. I went from going to the supermarket and grabbing 6 things and leaving to actually looking at the produce section with, oh, what am I going to make tonight? Which is, I think, that important step. With this documentary does the same thing. I think it takes these people of all different shapes, colors, sizes, and kind of makes the viewer realize that, like, hey, in a very short amount of time, you can reverse this thing. It's not impossible to change your life. One of the interesting things too about this documentary is that they, some of them fail at the end of this process, or some of them don't stick to the study. So I do think that they have a little bit of accountability of not everybody in the sample size is perfect, right? But also, I think that they do make a good, they make a point in the very beginning of the documentary, which I don't think that they stress enough, that they talk about this thing, this concept called the standard American diet, and SAD for short. And I think they show it to you in that preview there, right in the very beginning. Let me see if I can load that back up. And they talk about how difficult it is to actually eat healthy when you go out to eat. I've experienced this myself over the different ranges of weight. When you're really trying to stick to a vegetarian, vegan diet, you start looking around. Even in metropolitan areas, it's tough. When I was really sticking to the Whole 30, I was in New York City, and I couldn't believe walking down 14th Street, going towards Union Square, how many different places. I was like, I can't eat there, I can't eat there, I can't eat there. Now, of course, that diet itself was very regimented. It was fruits, vegetables, no sugar, anything. So a lot of things were off the table. But even in a place like New York City, which is like, claims itself for, vegetarian options. At the time, I didn't make any money, so I wasn't going to 11 Madison Park, a Michelin star restaurant. I was just trying to find anything that would work. So it ended up a lot of times I would be at Whole Foods and trying to kind of make my own food and make a healthy choice. But again, I think this documentary is a good watch. I think like anything else, it reminds me of the of the book Skinny Bitch, which kind of tells you about the dangers of the pathogens that your food are eating. And that's what this thing is interspliced with. It's a story about 4 twins going through a study, also interspliced with maybe the dangers of factory farming, the environmental causes, and the impact. And I think they do a good job of kind of juxtaposing those two next to each other. In a good way. Right when you start getting sick of hearing about, like, oh, okay, this is really, you know, harming the planet, blah blah blah. They kind of cut back to the study, to the more personal side of the actual story, and I think that's good. There are some awkward parts right at the second episode. There is an awkward part of the study that I don't think needed to be there. I often wonder if the producers were like, I don't think anybody's going to keep going on the second episode. We have to shock them into keep going. But there is an entire part dedicated to, you know, how sexually, you know, aroused one gets after a plant-based diet, and which is interesting. I think everyone knows the answer. If you're healthy, I think your sex drive goes up. Congratulations. No one needed that part of the study. So there is that little bit of it, if you're watching the show, that's going to be a little bit uncomfortable. But to watch, so don't watch it with your grandparents or cover grandma's eyes when that part of the documentary comes up. But they don't dwell on it very long. So you won't have to be talking to grandma that long. You know, after viewing it on Netflix. So, again, that was a really interesting documentary. It made me really start thinking about my weight loss journey, about my attempts to try to get fit, and also kind of reminded me, hey, you know, it doesn't take that much. It just takes sometimes diets seem impossible, but all it takes is just a smarter choice. We have three of these choices a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and you know, we're not hobbits. We don't need second lunch, third lunch, fourth lunch. We have three choices to make each day. And if you kind of reduce it down to that, even if you make two of those choices better, you're stepping in the right direction. And you can maybe start going towards a healthier lifestyle. So that, again, that's You Are What You Eat. It's four episodes long. It's a really easily digestible, about 3-4 hours of content. I highly suggest you go see it. I think it's an interesting documentary. I think they did a great job. Again, filmed beautifully. And also, too, it kind of gives you, it makes you interested in trying these things. I'm about to, maybe next week I'll come back. I bought a Beyond Burger to try because of this documentary. I'm not sure if Beyond is one of the good companies that you know, it's one of the best companies. But I'm going to try the veggie burger. I'm going to try some cashew-based cheese because of this documentary. And I think that's kind of cool. When some piece of content makes you go out and change something or buy something or do something, it stimulates you to do something, I think that's great. I think that's actually a great piece of content right there. One other thing before we move on, they do intersplice it also with a interesting story about 11 Madison Park, which is a Michelin restaurant that went all plant-based a couple years ago after gaining their Michelin status. And it goes through the dilemmas of how people perceive the change and how people dealt with the change and how he dealt with the change internally, the founder of 11 Madison Park. It's an interesting example to bring up in that most people probably watching, and this is a generalization, probably won't be able to afford going to 11 Madison Park. I think the Michelin restaurant server, I think the price that I looked up last night was like $365, $370 or something like that for the tasting. Maybe it was the big tasting. It's just an interesting thing because it piques your interest in the restaurant and then you're like, oh, damn, I gotta save up to go to some of these things. So it's a little bit of an out of reach example to set. You know, it would be interesting to kind of see that on a restaurant scale of something that people can actually kind of afford. But it's interesting, and I'm not sure too. Maybe they were trying to show economy of scale kind of within their documentary by showing very different levels of fine dining and how it's affecting fine dining, how it's affecting, you know, dining in poorly socioeconomic areas. Maybe that's what they were trying to kind of go for. But definitely I wanted to try it. but I don't know if I'm ready to put down that kind of money for a meal. Anyway, I'm going to close you with this. I'm going to try to wrap it up here. And I just saw this before I came on. And so I wanted to say happy birthday, obviously, first and foremost. I should have said that in the beginning of the show to my nephew, who is a Mario-loving and roller coaster loving dude. And I just saw this. So Super Mario World in Universal Japan is planning a Donkey Kong Country ride that apparently leaves the track. So I've got this video here loaded up, and I want to credit this video. This is from Coaster Talks video channel on YouTube. And right around the two-minute mark here, let's see if we're going to push to this clip, they start talking about the logistics of how this coaster is going to work. Now, obviously, this is based after the Minecraft level of the Donkey Kong Country series, where you're jumping, you know, gaps and stuff, and a minecart levels. And this coaster is going to emulate leaving the track by having a fake track above it, and then having the actual real track below it really guide the cart. Now, for everybody who doesn't like roller coasters and or struggles sometimes with fast, exciting rides, and you know, has a nephew that wants to ride every single one, to those uncles and aunts and moms and dads, I'm so sorry, guys. But we're all going to go on this ride. It's going to be awesome. We're probably going to all lose our lunch. But that's what we do when we love our families. Anyways, all right, guys. I think that's going to do it for the Powell Not Found podcast, episode 3. Technically, episode 4, because we had an episode 0. I got to probably stop saying that. But thank you guys all for watching. Again, go ahead and go to the YouTube channel, like, subscribe, hit that button. I might make a commercial. You know what? At the end of the month, maybe I'll make a commercial trying to do all that stuff so I don't have to say it within the podcast. But building our audience will help us, you know, get better and get that engagement going. So if you guys can do that for me, just go to the channel, hit that bell. It's free. Doesn't cost anything. And help me out. Leave me a comment. And tell me about what kind of segments you want to see in the future or something that you want to talk about. Anything will help kind of build this kind of audience going forward. So, again, thank you guys for your listenership and your support. Last week we put out a short that went that got 11,000 views and comments on my channel like I've never seen before, talking about the Bills Mafia shoveling the snow. I want to say I have the utmost respect for the Bills Mafia shoveling that snow. That's an amazing fan base right there. And, you know, obviously the roof comment is a joke, people. So what kind of cool engagement. I like that you guys kept it pretty civil in the comment section. So thank you for that. Anyways, thank you guys for your listener support. And with that, I think we're out. And you guys have a good weekend. Watch the football games. Josh Allen, go. Josh Allen, go. Take care, guys. Birthday celebration. Although she knew it was coming, we tried not to tell her. She brewed some Irish breakfast. Did she know her birthday was getting corona? Shake it off. She's losing track of the days.
gardens.